welcome in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to this commencement of the 2017 class of Lutheran Brethren Seminary. It is an honor to have you here and to honor our students. Our special honored guests today include past presidents of Lutheran Brethren Seminary, Reverend Joel Agee, LBS board members, Reverend Mr. Loyal Clark, who is the chairman and will bring greetings from the board, Reverend Paul Larson, the president of the Church of the Lutheran Brethren, and Reverend Matthew Rogness, the director of Lutheran Brethren International Mission, and alumni of Lutheran Brethren Seminary. Later in the program, we will introduce the families of our graduates. You are truly our honored guests, and we especially want to welcome you. Today, we are not only awarding degrees, we are sending into ministry. This day is significant for these students, but it is also significant for the Church of Jesus Christ. Ministers of the gospel have been better prepared to preach that everlasting gospel around the world. So we begin by singing praise to the one who created us and redeemed us. Number 3 in the Concordia hymnal, Praise to the Lord the Almighty. Would you stand as we sing together?
Join me in prayer. you, God, that you have called these graduates here and for your grace working in them. We thank you for your grace, Lord, also working around them in your people, the church. Now you commission them, Lord, and you send them with your authority to share the good news of Jesus Christ. By your authority, they go out with those around them. May they live out your command to love as you first loved them by giving your Son for them. And may they be supported in living out your love with those in their lives. May they remember that ministry involves both receiving and giving. Receiving what you have given them in Christ, so that they might give forth fruit. Receiving what you have given them in your church, so that they might give glory to your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We like to recognize alumni of Lutheran Brethren Seminary each year, and so you see a list there of milestone seminary graduates going all the way back to 75 years, and we've invited all of these persons to be present. I don't know how many were able to come, but as I read your name, I know at least one who is here. As I read your name, would you stand? And we just want to honor you and bless you as an alumni of Lutheran Brethren Seminary. From 75 years ago, George Wohl. From 70 years ago, Morris Werdahl. From 65 years ago, Arvid Christofferson and William Hunter. From 55 years, Ralph Yumbo and John Kildee. 50 years ago, Thor Foss and Glenn Larson. 25 years ago, Todd Anderson, Dean Johansson, Matthew Lundgren, Larry Olson, Bruce Stumbo, Ronald Sunwall, Daniel Tenefus, and Ted Weissout. Bruce, would you stand? you're representing all the alumni. I should say Pastor Stumbo. We went to seminary together and worked together. Well, our commencement speaker for the 2017 commencement is Reverend David Overland. Although when I first met him, I knew him as Dave, because we were little boys in Sunday school together. So we go back a long ways to Eau Claire, Wisconsin. We planned to work together as we became adults. We would sit in the swing on our farm and plan our futures, and our future was to farm together. And we had figured out even kind of how many sons we would each need in order to do all the work. So maybe that's what we learned early on, that you get people involved with you in ministry and then make them do all the work, right? And it doesn't quite work that way. But he is in part chosen as a commencement speaker because one of his confirmants, youth persons, youth workers, colleague in ministry, Alan Johnson, is a graduate here today, and so we're glad to have Reverend Overland as our speaker. His growing up years included time in Ferndale, Washington, Eau Claire, Wisconsin, and here in Fergus Falls. His education, he graduated from Hillcrest Lutheran Academy, has a bachelor's degree in business administration from the University of Washington, and a master of divinity from Lutheran Brethren Seminary, 1984. Correct? Yes. He has served as a pastor at Ebenezer Lutheran Brethren Church in Minneapolis, Minnesota, a church planter and pastor of Community of Joy, the Lutheran Brethren Church in Eagan, Minnesota, and then from 1994 till last May, pastor of Maple Park Lutheran Brethren Church in Lynnwood, Washington. He lives in Mukilteo, Washington. He is married to Nancy, and they have two sons. We welcome Reverend David Oberlin to give the 2017 commencement address.
Well, thank you very much, David. I would say President Beam. Distinguished faculty of Lutheran Brethren Seminary, honored graduates and guests, it's a pleasure being with you today. It's a real honor to be asked, invited to speak. Most of my life as a pastor, I felt like I had been in over my head. I remember in Eagan starting a church with 1 year of experience under my belt. I thought, there's no way that this could go. But God was with us. Then I went to Maple Park in Seattle, following after a beloved pastor, and had a lot of expectations, some of which have been met, some which have not. But I knew I was in over my head. This morning, or this afternoon now, I feel like I'm in over my head again. As I thought about what I could do that would be honoring to God and helpful to you, I went back some 33 years to my graduation from seminary. Following the graduation ceremony, my wife and my aunt put together a little celebration at my aunt's house. Friends and family came and wished me well and that sort of thing. Among the many guests, my mother and father attended the ceremony and the reception. My dad really wished that he could be somewhere else. I noticed that the crowd was disturbing to him. He had Parkinson's disease, and he started to tremble, started to shake. And at one point I said, Dad, would you like to get away for just a little bit so you could have a chance to settle down? And he said he'd like to do that. So we went outside to my car, and we sat there in silence for some period of time. Finally, I asked him, Dad, if you were able to do it over again, would you do it? He had been a pastor for 40 years. He sat there for a while. He didn't answer me very quickly. But he did respond finally, and he said, maybe not. Maybe not. I don't think I would. But if God had called me in the way that he called me when I was a young man, I would have no choice. Then he shared with me some difficult challenges he faced that led him to answer the way he did. He didn't share successes with me from his ministry, his years of ministry. He shared with me trials and disappointments that had come his way. Some that were very personal, some that had hurt him deeply. It hadn't been an easy road, and a price had been exacted. It's been said that some parents try and prepare the road for their children. Other parents try and prepare their children for the road. Graduates, I think you have been prepared for the road. And I'm glad that you have been. These years of spiritual formation in your life have enabled you to grow closer to God, to understand who He is. Even though, as much as you understand, you're still going to be floating in this boat of certainties, in the midst of a sea of uncertainties, as Brian Sonner would say. Know that the Holy Spirit is going to use the experiences that you'll be encountering in these next few years to bring about a transformation as it derives from the formation that you have received from your seminary training. But it won't be an easy road that you're entering into. I retired June 1 of last year. Before I retired, a friend of mine, Jay Price, pastor of Marysville Church in Washington, asked if we could get together and have lunch. I said, certainly. He came down to Maple Park, and we got into my car, prepared to leave the building. And before we even got to the driveway, he said, Dave, I have two questions for you. I two questions that have been burning on my mind. They may sound really silly to you, but I really want to know what you have to say about it. First question is this: how did you make it to the end? How did you last? The second question was, if you had a chance to do it over again, and I know you don't have a chance to do it over again, what would you do differently? How would it shape your day, your week, your month, your year? What you preach about? Who you see, who you don't see? In Jay's question, I heard an expression of struggle that many have experienced in pastoral ministry. Certainly I have. Not an easy road, but as I reflect on my years of ministry, I thank God for every one of them. I'm grateful to have had the opportunity to serve the Lord in this capacity, and especially in the two congregations that I ended up in, Community of Joy and Maple Park. But it wasn't easy. Jay and I left Maple Park and went to lunch. If I had kept the conversations with Jay superficial, I could have talked about the weekly grind of preaching, the treadmill, I call it, of preaching, even though I love preaching. Preaching, the counseling, visitation, administration, other pastoral responsibilities. Sometimes expectations that overwhelm you. I could have just gone on and talked about some of those things, but I think Jay was asking me about something deeper that all pastors deal with. So I went into some of the challenges that I had experienced that led me to question my calling, that made me say, I want out of here. I didn't sign up for this. I'll share two experiences with you that I shared with Jay so you understand where I'm coming from. And then maybe I'll share a little bit of what I learned from those experiences. The first story that I told him came after my first year at Maple Park. I had just come back from a week's vacation after my first year. I was meeting with an elder, having breakfast with him the first day back. Met him at Denny's. He handed me a letter and he said, Dave, I got this letter. I don't know what to do with it. It had come from the staff that I worked with. The letter was filled with accusations that ran about a page long, and it assailed my character, my professionalism, and my spirituality. The closing word of the letter was, the Spirit of God is not in him. I was shaken to the core of my being. I decided that I wasn't going to defend myself. Some of the things could be true. But I met with the elder board that night, and I said, here's my resignation. It's on the table. You take it if you want it. But you owe me this. You need to tell me if this is who I am, because I need to know. And if it's not, I need to know that as well. For whatever reason, I kept that letter in my drawer for about 10 years. Second experience I had shared also involved a letter. I had just come home from Fergus Falls, where I had attended a J-term. My son Aaron was at Hillcrest, and I was looking forward to both the J-term and seeing my son. I just returned home, and it was Saturday. I was scheduled to preach on Sunday. So my mind was a bit filled with thoughts about what I was going to say on Sunday. The church was in a bit of turmoil, to put it mildly. I was acutely aware of the unrest. I was sitting by the fireplace with Nancy, lost in thought, when she said, Dave, I need to tell you something. There's a letter going around, and it's not good. I just don't want you to be caught off guard. I looked at her and I said, you know, Nancy, February 22nd, 1998, that's the day I resigned. 3 months later, we'll go pick up Aaron. We'll go on a month vacation, and I'll find something else to do with my life. I didn't come here. I didn't come here to split a church. I'm out of here. I'll find something else to do with my life. Just so happened that Sunday, I was preaching from Acts 21. The Apostle Paul was on his way back to Jerusalem, having stopped in Caesarea at the house of Philip, who had four daughters who all prophesied. They urged Paul not to go back to Jerusalem because he would face great difficulty, be arrested, bound, and delivered to the Gentiles. But Paul would not be deterred. He had an agenda. He went to Jerusalem to give his report to the elders in Jerusalem, the council in Jerusalem, telling them all the wonderful things things that the Lord had been doing on his third missionary journey. The elders rejoiced, but they had an agenda as well. They said, "We want to talk to you, Paul, about a couple of things. We hear you've been speaking against the law of Moses and against circumcision. And if you want to come back into our good graces, here's a protocol that you can follow, that you can follow. And once you do that, everything will be fine." I was preaching that, and all of a sudden, I realized, you know, they weren't interested in him following the protocol. They weren't interested in being appeased. What they wanted is they wanted him gone. And some in my congregation wanted me gone, and my staff as well. It was Communion Sunday. After finishing my preaching, I was leading the words of institution, reading the words from our book. And I came to that part where it said, "Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing." And I stopped. And I couldn't start. I got stuck. I called to Peter Shantos, who was my associate at the time. I said, "Peter, can you come and help me?" He came to the front. I went out to the side door into a small room, and I wept. I wept for myself. I wept for my family. I wept for my church, and I wept for the witness of the gospel. I don't share these stories to get you to take sides, much less you feel sorry for me. I want to share with you how I grew from them. First of all, the life verse that I had chosen was Philippians 3:10, which says, "I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection, to share in the fellowship of his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, so that by any means possible I may attain to the resurrection from the dead." I wanted the power of his resurrection. I certainly didn't want to share in the fellowship of his sufferings. But God used this suffering to bring about growth in my life. The Apostle Paul suffered much, and he tells us that suffering produces perseverance. Perseverance produces character, and character hope, and hope does not disappoint. We all want character, we all want hope, but we don't necessarily like the process. I can tell you, I have much to learn about forgiveness, about humility, about dependence upon God, about listening, and the list goes on. Leaving would have come at great cost to me. I wanted to run, but God had something better in mind for me. He wanted me to face myself and what I needed to be accountable for. He was developing in me a character that needed shaping, that needed transforming. He was developing me as a pastor. He was developing a dependency upon him, his grace and his mercy, that would have remained much more superficial had I not continued in the struggle. He was teaching me that forgiveness comes at a great cost. There's nothing superficial about forgiveness. He was moving me from a theological understanding of forgiveness into an experiential understanding of the cost of forgiveness. Had I run, I would have lost. In the midst of it all, I found his promise to be true. I will be with you. Every congregation is a community of forgiven sinners, of which we are one. The word of God became my strength, and it gave me what I needed to press on. I read of a well-known pastor who had been severely criticized by some people in his congregation, who said this in response, "Lord, let this criticism develop a sweetness in me that I couldn't go without." That became my prayer. I know a time of testing will come for each of you. You will be tested. Allow it to develop a sweetness in your life. You'll be able to say with Job, "When he has tried me, I shall come forth as refined gold." Your calling is a great calling, but it's not an easy road. The text for this last Sunday in Easter, the second Sunday in Easter this year, landed on John 20:19-31. It's a wonderful story where Jesus appears in a locked room full of discouraged, hopeless, fearful disciples. They had experienced a rather traumatic event themselves, watching their Savior hung on a cross. Their hopes had been dashed, to pieces. They had run. They were hiding. They were wondering what the future held for them. Were they next in line to be crucified? Were the Jewish leaders coming for them? Now they were hiding. Suddenly Jesus appeared in their midst, and I was just so struck by this. The first words that he said to them were, "Peace be with you. Peace be with you." He didn't come in saying, "Why did you run? Why did you leave me? Why did you desert me? Let's go get those guys that did this to me." No recrimination, no signs of revenge. He said, "Peace be with you." And then he breathed on them the Holy Spirit, and they were told, "If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven. Withhold forgiveness, and it will be withheld in heaven." They knew that only God could forgive sins. How was it that they were going to be able to do that? But he had given them the authority and the power to do that. Forgive sins. Evidently, that was foremost in his mind. Let me ask you this. Is there anything that our world needs to hear more than the word of forgiveness? Instead of getting back at one another? You have the words of life, the words of forgiveness to bring to this world. I love the picture that Ezekiel saw described in chapter 47 of this book. The vision he saw was of a new temple, not a temple in Jerusalem, but a new temple that would one day come. And from that temple, there was a little trickle that was flowing out of the temple. I like to call it the beginning of a river of forgiveness. A little trickle was flowing out of the temple. They went a little ways further away from the temple, and it was ankle deep. And then they went a little further, and it was knee deep. They went a little further, and they could swim in this. They went a little further and it was rushing waters. It was going so fast that they couldn't swim across it. And wherever that river went, trees sprung up. And every month, fruit would be born. And the leaves of the tree would bring healing. And then it made its way to the Dead Sea. And the Dead Sea was made fresh water again. And fish began swimming. Wherever it went, it brought life. Ezekiel was seeing the new temple, the body of Jesus, of which we are a part. And he saw this free-flowing forgiveness that issued from the body of Christ, from the temple of Christ, which is the message that we have to bring. It was G.K. Chesterton who described the life of Francis of Assisi this way. He walked through the world as the pardon of God. Wouldn't that be wonderful to have someone say that of you, of me? They walk around the world as the pardon of God. The temple has a river of forgiveness that's flooding the world. The second question Jay asked had to do with doing things differently. I had given some thought to that, so I could answer quickly, and I will be brief here. What I want to do in retirement, I told him, is develop a prayer life that I never had as a pastor. When I went to work, I went to work. The tyranny of the urgent kept me from developing that prayer life. Not only that, but several times I had tried to pray. I was going to devote myself to 30 minutes of prayer a day. I listed all the missionaries, all the people that I thought needed prayer, and looked up, and about 33 minutes later, I was done, and it happened over and over again. I saw prayer as a utilitarian thing. Look in our church folders sometime on any given Sunday morning, and at the prayer request section, what do you see? Everybody's sick. Y'all need something. Y'all need somebody to fix this. And so we turn to God and we say, "Fix this," as if he doesn't know what's happening. Primary purpose of prayer, I've discovered, is not to get God to do what we think God ought to do, but to be properly formed. When Jesus taught his disciples to pray, he didn't suggest they just talk to God. He gave them something to say. He taught them a prayer. which is what his disciples expected. I have had the joy of finding a liturgy of prayer, morning prayer, that has brought life to my heart, to my words, to my marriage. A liturgy. I know we're not a liturgical church. People say that liturgy is dead. I want to say to you, liturgy is not dead or alive. It's true or false. Either you're dead or alive to the truth. I found this liturgy written by Brian Zahn that has given me life, as I've said before. It begins with an understanding of God. Father God, creator of heaven and earth, it begins right in the very beginning. God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the one who was called, the one who was chosen, the one who was redeemed. God and Father of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Oh, I forgot God of Israel. Now we're up to the Law and the Prophets. And then God and Father of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. True and living God, who was and is and always will be. Have mercy and hear my prayer. Being properly formed is coming into the presence of God and listening to Him, acknowledging who He is. After we've acknowledged who He is, then we have to acknowledge who we are, and so we confess. We bow before Him. We confess who we are, what we've done. Then we're ready to praise. It's a little bit like John Stott talking about prayer and worship. Kind of the same thing. He said he likens it to being invited to come to the White House. You think about what you're going to say or what you're going to do when you go to the White House. But you don't go charging into the Oval Office until you're invited to come in. That's what a call to worship is about. You're invited to come and worship. You prepared yourself for this. But then you wait until you're addressed and invited to come forward. Then you listen to the president. You listen to what he has to say. It would be impolite to not respond in kind to what he has just said. And so you would do that. And then at some point, he's going to ask you, and what can I do for you? What brings you here? You have a chance to express your thankfulness and your petitions. Focus on God. In that text from John, we read that Jesus breathed on them. I look at this liturgy of prayer as receiving the breath of God. It's a gift to me. It's a gift to us. In closing, I would just say this, my friends, my graduates, and my fellow graduates from this year. It's not an easy road that you're heading on. But the one who follows Christ to the end will never come to a bad ending. Let me pray. Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, give you humble thanks for all your great goodness and loving kindness to us and to all whom you have made. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all for your immeasurable love in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we pray, give us such an awareness of your mercies that with truly thankful hearts we may show forth your praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory throughout all ages. Amen.
It's my privilege this afternoon to introduce our graduates, 2017 LBS graduates. I'm going to read a bio that we've received from them and about them, and then after I read each bio, I'll invite the graduate and his family that are here to stand and be recognized. First graduate is Christian Anderson. Christian was born and raised in Brooklyn, New York, and came to know the Lord at 59th Street Church in Brooklyn and eventually became a youth pastor there from the college. Christian is married to Mary, whom he met at 59th Street Church. Christian attended high school at Fort Hamilton High School in Brooklyn and later Sayville High School in Sayville, New York. He did his undergraduate studies at Wagner College, Staten Island, New York, studying history and political science. Later transferring and graduating from Nyack College, studying youth ministry and biblical theology. Christian is graduating today with a Master of Divinity degree. He has accepted a call to serve as the East Campus Pastor for Congregational Life at Triumph Lutheran Brethren Church in Moorhead, Minnesota, and begins in July. Christian, you and your family that are here today, please stand. Studies in social science education with a history minor and a coaching minor at North Dakota State University. After working 3 years as a middle and high school social studies teacher and basketball coach at a private Christian school in Brooklyn Park, Minnesota, Ben moved to Fergus Falls to begin seminary at LBS. Ben is married to Jenna Lee and they have 2 children, Luke, 2, and Madison, 4 months. Ben is graduating with a Master's of Divinity degree and will continue a call he began last summer serving as Associate Pastor at Oak Hill Lutheran Brethren Church in Bloomington, Minnesota. Ben, junior family, please. Kevin Clinton. Kevin was born and raised in Rancho Cucamonga, California. Just love saying that name. Rancho Cucamonga. He was a member of Victory Community Church in Rancho and eventually began working there as a youth program director. Kevin attended Edwin High School and after that took up college studies at Ball State University in Muncie, Indiana, where he received a bachelor's degree in philosophy. Kevin began his studies at LBS in the fall of 2015 and is graduating today with a certificate in theological studies with an emphasis in lay ministry. Following graduation, Kevin will remain in Fergus Falls and is open to the Lord's leading for future ministry opportunities. Kevin, please stand. Chris Hartley. Chris grew up in Wheatland, Iowa, and attended grade school and high school in the Bennett Community School District. Chris received a Bachelor's of Education degree from the University of Northern Iowa, and a Master's of Education in Differentiated Instruction from Graceland University. For nearly 10 years, Chris worked as an art teacher at one time or another teaching all levels, K through 12. Prior to coming to LBS, Chris served as an elder at Emmaus Road Church in DeWitt, Iowa, and volunteered with their tweens program and their youth group. Chris is married to Lisa, and they have 2 children, Isabel, 13, and Grant, 9. Chris is receiving a Master of Divinity degree today, and from here will continue to serve in a call he began last summer as pastor of Congregational Life at the LB Church in Williston, North Dakota. Chris, you and your family, please. Jordan Herrick. Jordan grew up in Colfax, Wisconsin, and graduated from Colfax High School. Prior to starting classes at LBS, he worked as an adjunct instructor teaching the Central Service Technical Program at the Chippewa Valley Technical College in Eau Claire, Wisconsin. He also worked in Eau Claire at the Marshfield Clinic Surgery Center. Jordan received a Central Service Technician degree and also took general education courses at Chippewa Valley Tech in Eau Claire. Jordan is married to Gretchen, and they have 2 children, Spencer, 17, and Sydney, 14. Jordan is graduating with a certificate in theological studies, an emphasis in Bible studies, After graduation, Jordan plans to continue serving as an associate pastor at Bethany Lutheran Church in Colfax, Wisconsin, while also working as a special ed para in the Colfax School District. Jordan, would you and your family like to say? Alan Johnson. Alan grew up in Linwood, Washington. Attended Maple Park Lutheran Brethren Church. Prior to and during the time, Alan took classes at LBS, starting way back in the fall of 2012. And he worked as the director of youth ministry at Maple Park. Alan graduated from Snohomish County Christian School and earned a Bachelor of Arts, interdisciplinary degree in culture, literature, and the arts from the University of Washington. Alan is married to Cheryl, and they have one daughter, Elsie, who's 1.5 years old. Alan graduates today with a Master of Divinity degree, having the special distinction of being the first of our LBS graduates to both start and finish his program in a distance ed format. Alan is currently open to call. I invite you, Alan, to stand in your family. Saskatchewan, Canada. He attended high school at Hillcrest Lutheran Academy. After high school, Daniel participated in the CLB serving teams before starting up a band and playing on both coasts for 8 years. I think that sounds pretty impressive. Isn't it?
Good.
Coast to coast. Eventually, Daniel took up a youth, started the youth and young adults director position at Peace Lutheran Church in Calgary, Alberta, before arriving on site here in Fergus Falls to begin his studies at LBS. Daniel is married to Karen, and they have 5 children, Judah, 7, Asher, 6, Caleb, 4, Silas, 2, and Elijah, 3 months. Daniel has done undergraduate work at both South Puget Sound Community College and the University of Phoenix. Today, Daniel is receiving the Diploma of Christian Ministry. Daniel has accepted a call to serve as pastor at Calvary Lutheran Church in Bergenfield, New Jersey, and will begin this August. Daniel, you and your family, please.
Graduates, faculty and staff, seminary family and friends, it is my privilege to bring you greetings on behalf of the Lutheran Brethren Seminary Board. This afternoon we give all praise, honor, and glory to our gracious God who brought you to the Lutheran Brethren Seminary and to this place and time where he saw fit to celebrate this day with family and friends. Today does not mark the end of your preparation and training. Perhaps it is a waypoint in the journey of your call to ministry. What excites me the most about God's calling is knowing that he owns the ministry. Your steps and your heart to do the work that was prepared in advance for you. There will be moments of questioning and doubt, as well as wonder and the filling sense of God's purpose. Rely on your training, but more importantly, surrender your heart to the leading of the one who created it, knowing the tasks before you. You are being sent into a world that desperately needs Jesus. What other job can be more satisfying? What work can be more important? We are all called to tell people the good news of Jesus, yet you have been chosen to go and make disciples. You are called to many roles in God's church, and he has gifted you to serve in leadership in that leadership capacity. The key is service. Jesus washed the feet of his disciples, and as he did that, he certainly demonstrated his love, but his point to impress upon his disciples was the gravity of being a servant. In the knowledge of who they serve. As he said in this example, saying, "Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet." Your pursuit of this calling has brought you to places within yourself that you probably didn't know existed. Your professors, staff, families, home congregations, as well as brothers and sisters in Christ that you do not know, have been praying for you as their own family. I've prayed over ground, planted in you are seeds that will be deposited in far-reaching places over your lifetime of service. Fruit will be born and lives will be changed by the grace of the Holy Spirit that lives in you, and then on to others, this cycle will repeat. And you may never know its reach until we all meet in glory praising God. It is a good thing that God is the one who equipped you. And it is a good thing that he has given us all a desire to call upon his name in behalf to hold you and keep you in the palm of his hand as you are sent in his name into a world to meet the lost with the gospel. With this said, and with great joy, in anticipation of what is to come, congratulations to you all.
Will the candidate for the Certificate of Theological Studies in Lay Ministry please rise? President Beam, the candidate for the Certificate of Theological Studies in Lay Ministry, has met all of the requirements for the certificate as prescribed by the Board and Faculty of Lutheran Brethren Seminary. It is my pleasure to recommend him for the Certificate of Theological Studies in Lay Ministry.
Upon the recommendation of Dr. Bo, Dean of Lutheran Brethren Seminary, and by virtue of the authority vested in the office of the President by the Board of Lutheran Brethren Seminary, it is my privilege to award you the Certificate of Theological Studies in Lay Ministry with all of its rights and privileges.
Jordan Herrick. Will the candidate for the Certificate of Theological Studies in Bible and Theology please rise? President Beam, the candidate for the Certificate of Theological Studies in Bible and Theology, has met all of the requirements for the certificate as prescribed by the Board and Faculty of Lutheran Brethren Seminary. It is my pleasure to recommend him for the Certificate of Theological Studies in Bible and Theology.
Upon the recommendation of Dr. Bo, Dean of Lutheran Brethren Seminary, and by virtue of the authority vested in the office of the President by the Board of Lutheran Brethren Seminary, it is my privilege to award you the Certificate of Theological Studies in Bible and Theology with all of its rights and privileges.
Kevin Clinton. Will the candidate for the Diploma in Christian Ministry please rise? President Beam, the candidate for the Diploma in Christian Ministry, has met all of the requirements for the degree as prescribed by the Board and Faculty of Lutheran Brethren Seminary. It is my pleasure to recommend him for the Diploma in Christian Ministry.
Upon the recommendation of Dr. Bo, Dean of Lutheran Brethren Seminary, and by virtue of the authority vested in the office of the President of Lutheran Brethren Seminary, it is my privilege to award you the Diploma in Christian Ministry degree with all of its rights and privileges.
Daniel Stenberg. Will the candidates for the Master of Divinity please rise? President Beam, the candidates for the Master of Divinity have met all of the requirements for the degree as prescribed by the Board and Faculty of Lutheran Brethren Seminary. It is my pleasure to recommend them for the Master of Divinity.
Upon the recommendation of Dr. Bo, Dean of Lutheran Brethren Seminary, and by virtue of the authority vested in the office of the President by the Board of Lutheran Brethren Seminary, it is my privilege to award you the Master of Divinity degree with all of its rights and privileges.
Christian Anderson. Ben Bigelet. Christopher Hartley. Helen Johnson. Will the graduating class Lutheran Brethren Seminary 2017. Please rise. We present to you the class of 2017.
Day. Thank you all for being here. After the recessional, there will be a receiving line in the foyer, and then you're all invited to come for lunch in the fellowship hall, which is across the hallway to your right, and have a chance to greet and talk and congratulate all of them and just enjoy our time together. As we send them on their way, and as God sends all of us on our way, we sing number 32 in our blue hymnals. The servants of God, your master proclaim. Let's stand as we sing together. Remain standing for the benediction.
Equip you with everything good for doing his will, and may he work in us what is pleasing to him through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen.